Hello and welcome to the Z Hut. Today I'm going to show you how to build a Bluetooth controlled Photogate for high speed photography. Now, about a year and a half, going on 2 years ago, I did a video on how to build a Photogate, and that one used a old TV remote to control everything, and it had an LCD screen. Well, since then, in my spare time, I've been working on a revised version of it using Bluetooth, because nowadays everybody's got a smartphone or a tablet, and this eliminates that LCD screen and allows you to compact things more and made it lighter. And I've also come up with a couple other add-ons that are different from the original. Now, I'll have a link in the description below if you would like to check out that original video. But I think if you're going to build one of these, you're probably going to want to do the Bluetooth controlled one. It works a lot better. So what we'll do first is we'll go over how this is put together. Then I'll plug it in and grab my tablet and bring the app up and I'll demonstrate it working. Then what we'll do is we'll take a look at the schematic after that and how to wire this up. Alright, well first let's take a look at the gates. Now I have two different photo gates here. Now we'll look at the small one first. This one is designed for like water drop photography. It has just a little photo interrupter, and these are cheap. These are under a dollar for these little things. And the nice thing is these both plug right in. You have to change nothing. It's the same app, the same controller box, everything's the same. Because the little infrared LED and infrared transistor that are used in both the gates work at the same voltages and levels. So nothing has to be changed. Now, one of the big differences on these gates from the one I did in my original video is my original video, I had a relay that you used to turn a lamp off and on. Because when you're doing the high-speed photography, you want it pitch black, dark. No light, period. Well, I didn't think that was very safe, and I wanted to get away from that. So what I've done is I went down to my local dollar store, and I picked up two little cheap LED flashlights that take the three AAA batteries, took the head off of it, and just hot glue gunned it into the PVC piping. That's all there is to it. And the nice thing is, too, it's adjustable. So if you want it pointed so you can see where your water dropper is, just point it forward. If you want to see, you know, down below, you can point it at yourself if you wanted to, but this eliminates having to use the relay, and it just uses the transistor. I can't remember if I have it on transistor or just on the microcontroller. We'll get to that when we get to the schematic. But once you activate it and you're ready to take the picture and you hit the start button, the light turns off. And then after you take your picture and the camera shutter closes, it turns the light back on. That way you're not trying to turn a light off and on, stumbling in the dark and breaking something. Now for the bigger photo gate, let me set that off to the side, it uses the same thing. It's got a light on here and it's adjustable so you can aim it. It's the same flashlight as I used on the other one. And then we got our RCA plugs. But this one is made more for like if you were going to be dropping bottles and wanted to get a picture of them as they're breaking, not after it's broke, but as it's breaking, a gate like this would be the way to go. You could also use this, you know, if you're dropping balls in the water to get some giant splashes. And you can make it wider than this. I made mine just a little bit bigger than the largest bottle that I was going to be dropping through here. But you could always make it bigger. And otherwise, it works in the same principle as the smaller gate. There's a infrared transistor on one side and an infrared diode on the other. So you're not going to visibly be able to see the light that this is giving off. And also any ambient light that is in the room, which you shouldn't have any, but if any is there, it won't affect the operation. This all works in infrared. Now it will pick up a TV remote. I'm not sure if it'll trigger it or not if you pointed it right at it, but it would pick that up and it might interfere with it, but I don't think you're going to be using anything like that while you're doing this. All right, so let me set this gate off to the side so we can see the control box here a little easier. Now, if you have watched my other video, I had it all on a solderless breadboard and wires going everywhere and all over the place. I found these little boxes at my local hardware store, and it's called a conduit body. And it was like, I think it was $2.99 or $3.50, somewhere near. They're dirt cheap. And everything fit inside this perfectly. And the nice thing is the gates attach right to it, just like that. You're using this one, you pop it on. If you're done with it, you pop it off, stick the other one on. Works great. Now, to attach it to a stand, you can use a tripod if you wanted. But what I came up with is one of these bicycle handlebar mounts. I found these, I was at the Goodwill or Salvation Army, and they had a bunch of them for $1 each. So I grabbed a few, and I actually got one on the camera right here. It's got my shotgun mic holding it onto the camera tripod. These work great for all kinds of things. And it works really good for this, because instead of putting this on a tripod, I have one of them overhead boom lights, video lights. And I just took the light off and mount this on it. And then I can have this several feet away from the stand. And the stand has a counterweight on the other side of the boom, so it's not going to tip down or tip up. Just make sure you get the weight right. And that allows you to have lots of room underneath for where your bottle's going to be breaking or your water splashes are going to occur. And you don't have to worry about the stand being in the way. But if you don't have one of them and don't want to invest in it, a tripod will work fine for this. You are definitely not going to want to try to hand hold this. It just isn't going to work. Out of 1,000 pictures, you might get one to work. But now, another thing is, you can see on the top, this is where we plug our RCA plugs in. And make sure you correspond the colors to match your plugs so that you know which one to plug in to where. Then I simply have an off-on switch. And then here I have a plug, one for the flash and one for the camera. And then I just simply made up my own lines. I use a Canon, so that's the plug I needed, just a little audio plug. But I think it was the Nikons use a different kind of plug. And you're going to want to make your cables to match whatever you're plugging into. Most of your flashes will use that plug. Now, another thing, if your flash does not have a port to plug in to trigger the flash remotely, you can get a hot shoe that you put it on, and it'll have the output of the hot shoe will have one of these plugs, and you can use that with this. So if your flash or speed light doesn't have that feature, you can always just order one of those adapters, those hot shoe, I forget the exact name of it, it's a hot shoe adapter something. I'll have links to that on the website. And of course, before I forget, you'll find a link to the website in the description below. Now, another thing I've added is, instead of only being able to power this with 5 volts, I put a 5 volt voltage regulator on the back with a heat sink. And then I got a plug in here. You can run this anywhere from 7 to 12 volts. So if you wanted to use a 9 volt battery to make it a little more mobile, you don't want a cable hanging, you can use that. Or you can use like a little battery pack. Otherwise, I normally just plug it into my wallboard, into the wall, and I usually run about 7 or 9 volts to it. If you've got 7 volts, use 7. If you got 9, use 9. You know, don't just plug the 12. If you've got a smaller one, use it, because the higher the voltage you use, the warmer this heat sink will get in the back. It's most likely not going to heat up enough, you know, to melt anything, but the less voltage you use, the better. The better. Unfortunately, you can't run just 5 volts into it. I will tell you this, it will work, but it'll be a little sluggish because it's trying to run the 5 volts through the 5 volt regulator, and the output actually is going to be under 5 volts. And believe it or not, Arduino, which is what we're using as the brains of this, will run on a lower voltage. Just the clock speed slows down, so your timing's going to be off on your settings. And like I said, the brains of it is an Arduino microcontroller, and I'm just using a Nano. You could use a Pro Mini, something like that, but you want the smallest board possible, and the Nano isn't too much bigger than the Pro Mini. If you were going to use like an Uno or a Mega Arduino microcontroller, you would probably have to build your control box to be separate from the photo gates and then run lines. And that would work, but this just it looks really nice. And when I once I get done shooting this video, I'll take some pictures of it on the stand and I'll have those on the website. And you'll see what I mean. It looks really professional and cool having it set up this way. See, there's nothing really else. Oh, yes, there is one more thing. I also added a little speaker. It's on the bottom. And what this does is after you start the process, you hit the start button on the app. It takes a moment, for the camera shutter to open. Well, the light turns off first, then the camera shutter opens. And what happens is after it is completely ready to go, ready for you to drop your item through it, a little tone goes off. And you'll hear that in a moment here. I'm gonna plug this in and demonstrate it working. And can't remember if I went over. There's an off and on button on here. And yeah, if you wanted to run this on a 9-volt battery, you could just get rid of this plug and put a clip under here to hold the 9-volt battery, and then run your plug-in line through. And you wouldn't necessarily need it, but you still might want to put it. Your 9-volt battery goes dead, and you still want to keep shooting. You've got the option of plugging right into a wall wart. All right, well, let's see. I'll demonstrate it working on the big one here. Make sure everything's still in the camera range. Plug our leads in. Right, I've got my voltage source. We'll turn it on. It takes just a moment, and there we go. I'll flip this up so you can see. There we go. I'll turn it on again, and you'll see after just a moment, the light comes on. That means it's ready to go. All right, everything is lined up. Let me grab my tablet here. Now, this will work with any Android device. You can use the tablet or you can use your phone. Unfortunately, at this time, I don't have an app for the Apples. I am trying to work on getting somebody to put an app together. I've never really dealt with the iPhone stuff, so I don't know how to do it. I know how to write Android apps. All right, I got the app brought up here. I'm getting some reflection off of that light, so we'll just turn it off. All right, what we got here first is we got to connect and disconnect, and this is to connect to our Bluetooth. So now that we're powered up, we want to connect to our Bluetooth, and then you select your Bluetooth device that you're connecting to. Now I went ahead and renamed mine Photogate so I know which one it is. It takes it a moment to get connected. There we go, and then it says right up here in green, connected. So now what we got, we're going to skip down to the bottom here. Because when you first set this up, you got to figure out your triggering threshold. So I've added it on here. You hit that and you see numbers come up down here. Now you can get a number anywhere between 0 and 10, was it 1023 or 1024? I think it's 1024. And if I put my hand between the gate, you see that number goes down. It goes down pretty low. Now I put this function in there just so you can set your sensitivity. Now we're at 1023. And it's holding there pretty good, so we could probably set this. Oops, going the wrong way. Set that up, and I just set it up for a range between what was the bottom? Between 100 and 999. So at 999, it's going to trigger. It's not going to take much going through there. And this thing reads really quick. I mean, you could throw the item through it, and it's going to pick it up. So once you figure your threshold out, just click it again to stop it, because if you forget to do that when you try to start it, it won't start. So if that happens, just remember to push the button again. The number stays there. You see, I put my hand in there, it doesn't change the value. So next, what we have here is the bulb timer. Now, what this is it'll be how long your camera shutter will stay open. So if you start it, and I've got it set at 10 seconds right now, in 10 seconds, if nothing goes through and it doesn't activate it, it automatically just resets and turns the light back on and closes the camera shutter. So I'm going to leave that at 10, but you can go anywhere from 10 seconds up to a full minute. So there's quite a bit of range in there. Now here is the one that you really got to play with, the flash delay. This is how long it will take after it detects the item going through the photo gate. It will delay, and this is in milliseconds, how long before the flash is triggered. So once you figure out, after a couple sample shots, you should be able to figure out roughly where to set your flash delay to catch the bottles or the water drops at the same time. And what this will allow you to do is get repetitivity in taking your pictures instead of just trial and error trying to use your little camera release button. And trust me, I've tried that and it sucks. Like one or two pictures out of 100 tries, I think, was my best. With this, it's almost a 50-50 and sometimes even better than that. Just depends. If you're doing water drops, it's a little more finicky. If you're doing bottles, you probably get this thing once you get everything set. You're going to probably get 80-90% of them easily. So, in the flash delay in milliseconds. Let's see here. Something glitched out on me quick. Sorry about that. The app glitched out on me for some reason. I've actually never had that happen before. That's the first time. All right, sorry about that little delay, but it's coming back up here. Another nice thing I added into this is it saves your settings. So if you shut it off and you turn the app back on, wherever you had it set last time, it's going to be still at those settings. There we go. So you can use the slider or you can use these little arrows. Either one will move it. I usually, you know, get roughly where I want with the slider and then use the arrows on each side to fine tune it. So is this, okay, the trigger needs to be turned off. Oh, come on, turn off. There we go. So let's start it. You see the screen goes black. Let's see here. Turn this up. Oops. She's being stubborn. I've never actually had this problem before. That's really weird. All right, let's try this again. She is being real stubborn today. Well, you see when it goes to activate, the screen goes blank, and after it takes a picture, you just got to manually tap your screen. I'm just not sure what the heck is going on here. This has actually never done this to me before. So let's try something here. I'm just going to reset it. The tablet must have glitched out and just glitched everything. I've actually never had this problem before, but if it happens, this is all you got to do is just turn it off and restart it. There we go. We're connected. Our settings are all where they were before. Hit start. There we go. Then you heard the tone. After light went out, your camera shutter opened. And once you hear that tone, then you drop your item and the camera shutter closes. Light comes back on, you tap your screen. I'm sorry about that little glitch out there. I really don't know what was going on there. I've never had that problem before. If it does it to me again, I'll check the app. I might have accidentally goofed something up, but I'll check into that. But all right. I can't really think of anything else to go over on the app. Just demonstrate it again. There you go. So I think what we'll do is we'll go over to the computer and I'll bring up the schematic on this and give you a quick walkthrough. It's not that difficult to put together, and I did build the whole thing on a solderless breadboard, and I did that so I can continually do modifications to this. But if you wanted to, you could, you could go ahead and just solder this onto a PCB. So, All right, I got this all powered off, so we'll go over and bring up the schematic and run through it. So I'll catch you there in just a moment. Okay, I've got the schematic brought up here. Now, before I forget, if you would like a copy of the schematic to print out, if you're going to be building this, just look in the description below and you'll find a link to this project's website. And also the app will be on there to download. It's completely free. At this time, I don't have it on the Google Play. I'm working at getting an account to be able to start putting my apps on there. But I have the APK file available to download, and just go to the website and you'll find that, and you'll find the schematic, and you'll find a parts list and some links to where to get any of these parts if you don't have them. All right, let's just get into it. I guess we'll start right in the center here, and this is our Arduino Nano. And like I said earlier in the video, you could use, like the Pro Mini. Just try to, use one of the small ones. I like the Nanos because it has the USB programming port built into it. The Nanos, Pro, or excuse me, the Pro Minis, you have to have a separate little board to program them. And that's why I go with the Nano, because I continuously change things, and I'm actually, after I do this video, there's a couple other ideas, upgrades. So probably, 6 months, a year down the line, I'll have an updated version of this. And some of the things I was thinking of adding are like presets, and I figured that would be nice to have. And that shouldn't be too much programming to add that into the app. And then, of course, like I said, I would like to find somebody that can program an app for the iPhones as well. But if you don't have an Android device, go on eBay. You'll find an old, outdated phone for like $15, $20, and that'll work fine for this. All right, so we got our Arduino, our Nano. And then, of course, we're powering everything. Here's our 5 volt regulator. And then we got our input. And I just, the recommended 9. 9 volts works good, but you can run anywhere between 7 and 12. And just make sure the power supply you're using, if you're using a wall wart, if it says 12 volts on it, it's going to probably be closer to 14. You can use that, don't worry. I just said 12 because, at 15 volts, this thing breaks down. So just use a voltmeter and test it. But if it says 12 volts on the wall wart, it's going to be like 13 and a half, somewhere in there. You can go ahead and use that, it'll be fine. And like your 9 volt wall warts, they're generally closer to like 10 to 11. And let's see, the 7 volt was around 8 something. I don't know why they put 9 volts on it when it's actually 10 or 11, but that's how they are. But if you use a 9 volt battery, that's gonna be just a little bit above 9. Not if I remember right, it's like 9.5 on a 9 volt battery. So you'll be fine, perfectly fine. And then with that, we just got two capacitors that hook with this voltage regulator, and that stabilizes it. So I'm not going to go into the theory of why they're there. Just make sure you add those, and then make sure your all our grounds, everything, all the grounds are connected to each other. You want a common ground on everything. All right, well then let's just move right on down here. We got our Bluetooth device. Now I'm actually not using the Bluetooth Silvermate in the software I'm using to write make the schematic. It's called Fritzing. They don't actually have the HCL6s or the HCL5s, and that's what I used. Either one will work, HCL6 or an HCL5. The difference between them is an HCL6 is just a slave Bluetooth board, and an HCL5 is a master or slave. Now, if you get the HCL5, don't worry, out of the package, it's programmed to be a slave. You only have to go into the command mode on it if you want to switch it to a master, or if you want to, there's some other things you can change on it as well. All right, and then out of there. Now, normally, I don't use a voltage divider because an Arduino is 5 volt logic and our Bluetooth device is 3.3. So you got to have the RX, which goes to the TX. You have to have a voltage divider in there. Otherwise, I usually use logic level converters, and I run it on both sides, the RX and TX. I needed to keep this project as small as possible, and I was running out of room on the breadboard, so I was forced to go with the voltage divider. It works fine for this, and we just use a 10K and a 5K and just wire it up, as you can see here in the schematic. The logic level converter, there just unfortunately was not enough room. Now, let's see here, the TX to the let's see here, TXR. The other one, which is the RX to the TX, that one you can connect straight through. The Arduino board will recognize it, even though it's only 3.3 volt logic. It will work fine. You don't have to put a voltage divider on that side. All right, next let's move over up to the top here. This is our LED, that's the flashlight. Now you can use individual LEDs. Maybe you wanted to put them on the bottom side of the photogate, facing down, and maybe a couple facing in, so you got a lot more light lighting up around it. And that'll work fine. You could actually run quite a few LEDs. Just make sure, depending on how you hook them up, you use the correct resistance in there, because your LEDs will not handle the 5 volts. They'll smoke instantly at that. So that's why I did not put a value for this resistor. You will have to either play around with resistors or do Ohm's Law. And Ohm's Law ain't very hard. If you don't know how that works, YouTube's got a million videos on that. So look it up if you're in doubt. Otherwise, just start out with a big resistor, like a 1K, and work your way down until the LEDs are about as bright as they should be, and stop right there. Don't go any lower. Well, you can also use, they got them Piranha LEDs that are super bright. I actually ordered some of them, and for the next version, it'll probably be coming out in a half year to a year, is going to have about a dozen of them on it, and it basically is going to light the whole room up. And that's going to be a nice feature, but the flashlight works pretty good. I've actually tried taking some pictures with this, and that flashlight worked fine. The next here, this is our actual photogate. Here's the photo transistor, the infrared transistor, and the infrared LED. And they're both on 220 ohm resistors. We got to limit the current because they won't handle the full 5 volts. And then we've got the let's see here, the photo transistor comes through and that connects up to A1. And did I mess that wiring up right there? Yes, I forgot to add one little detail. There should be another line here. Before I upload this to the website, I will correct this. But this little junction right here should also connect to ground. I'm sorry, I forgot to put that in there, but when you get the schematic off the website, I will fix that error. Because what we're doing when we set the phototransistor up is we're setting it up as a voltage divider. It's the readings are much more stable, and then your ambient light and stuff doesn't really mess with it, which you shouldn't have that problem anyway, because when you're using this, the light should be out. But it reads a lot better set up as a voltage divider, and we're just using 100K ohm resistor there. And like I said, this point right here needs to be connected to ground as well, and I will update that before I upload this to the website. And of course, next we've got the speaker that's right here, and I'm using a tone, and I just used a transistor in there because then it makes the speaker about 3 times louder. If you didn't want to mess with that, you can run the pin just directly off a D3 to the speaker, and then hook the other side to ground. By using this transistor, I'm using a NPN. You have this side is controlling the ground, and the other goes straight to VCC. So you just reverse that, put the positive to pin 3, and put the negative straight to ground. Otherwise, a 2N, 2222 transistor, which is super common, or anything even remotely similar, is going to work. It's going to work fine, and that's the same thing I used here. This controls turning the flashlight off and on, and it's the same transistor. I use the 2N2222. There's also the 2N, was it 3904? something like, I think that's what it was, a 3904. That will work almost, any of your small signal transistors are going to work fine for this. Let's see. Then we have down here is our flash and our camera control. We are using optical couplers, optocouplers. It kind of works on the same principle as the Photogate, except it's inside an enclosure, so you cannot physically interrupt the light. What this does is when it turns this LED on full, the IR transistor is allowed to let current flow through it, and that activates the flash. And the same thing here for the camera. When current is applied to the internal LED, the internal transistor, phototransistor, picks that up and allows your voltage to run through. Now, for hooking up to the camera and the flash, your instruction manual will have a schematic in there. I know Canon does for sure. I'm almost positive Nikon will, and those other Panasonic, Sony's, all of them should have that in the user's manual and just wire it up accordingly. Make sure you're bringing your voltage in and then down to ground. And the schematic, I actually didn't use the TLP621. Almost any of your optical couplers that, there's got to be hundreds of different ones. I can't remember offhand which one I'm using. I'll have it in the parts list though. You're going to be able to use almost any optical coupler you come across. Just make sure these things won't handle 5 volts, just like these won't. This one actually had to run even less voltage than the IR transistor and LED over here. So I used a 330 ohm. That will probably work with most of them you run across. Just check the data sheet on what the maximum voltage that you can put through this is. And on the camera side and the flash side, you don't have to worry about that. If I remember right, the camera is only like a volt or something like that. And the flash is being triggered off and on so quick, it doesn't matter. The flash could probably have 30 volts and it's on and off so quick, it ain't going to heat up and destroy it. All right, I think we've covered everything. I think we have. And like I said, a couple of these items aren't marked the specific part number on the schematic here. I might go into my photo editing software and change some of these before I upload it. And I will make sure I add that ground line in there. I can't believe I missed that. But yeah, you'll find a full parts list on the website if I don't get all that in there. And like I said, the app can be found on there and some other information. I'll have some pictures as well of this, the Photogate hooked up on its stand. All right, well, I think we're done. This video is dragged on here. It's got to be coming up close to 30-minute long video. So with that, I guess I'd like to say thank you for joining us here at the Z Hut today. I hope you found this information useful. If you did, please give me a thumbs up and don't forget to subscribe. I do quite a bit of videos on electronics, dealing with the microcontrollers, Arduinos and stuff, but I do some photography stuff, and I really like combining the two, photography and the microcontrollers. And you'll see I have a few videos on that. Like, I've got a camera slider I built out of an old scanner bed and a few other videos. But on occasion, I do just strictly photography, but I got a bunch of photography videos on my channel as well from like a year and a half, 2 years ago. I did a big stretch of just photography videos. So, all right. Well, thanks for joining us. And remember, have fun building.